Good morning, Acts 2 Worship Center. Let's stand up together. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your presence in this place. Thank you, God, that we have freedom this morning. Thank you, Lord, that you are a real God, a God who loves us, a God who is here now, a God who is active in our lives, not a God who is far and distant and pointing his finger at us, but you are a God who has his arms wide open, Lord. We know who you are, Father, and that's who we worship, and we worship you because of your faithfulness. We worship you because of your greatness, Lord God. And we ask you, Father, to move in this place this morning, to move in our hearts this morning, God. Would you give us a joy, Father, that only you can give us? Even if we don't feel it right now, would you give it to us, Lord Jesus? Would you give us a faith, Father, to believe that you are who you say you are, God? Even if we don't feel it, God, would you give us faith to believe these words that we sing, Lord Jesus? Do it in the name of Jesus, God. And we pray this in your name.
Yeah.
Father, that you're always with us, God. Thank you, God, that we have a real joy. Thank you, God, that we have life in you, God, because of the cross and because of what you've done. We have so much to celebrate this morning, God. We may have come here with our head bowed down, Father, but we have so much to look up to, and that's you, Jesus. So we lift our head because you are the lifter of our head, God. And we set aside everything else, God, and we focus on what you've done on the cross for us, because that is our strength, Lord. And I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would strengthen all of our hearts this morning here in your presence, together as one, as we worship in spirit and in truth, God. We thank you.
Gloria, gloria, te doy gloria, gloria, Jesús. Conquer the Start over again. It is just that easy. And it's because of you, because of your sacrifice, because of your love, because of your gift of salvation. So this morning, Lord, we take the bread and we remember what you've done for us. We remember what you died for our salvation, for our healing, for our strength, for our witness. Empower us today, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. We can take the bread. Overcoming, overwhelming power in your blood. Lord, just as in the Old Testament, they would take the blood and they would put it over their doorpost as protection. You protect us. You watch over us. You care for us. And Lord, sometimes bad things still happen to us. And the enemy would attack people's minds and say, where was your God? But we declare in the face of the enemy that you are the God that sticks closer than a brother. You are everything your word says you are. And we won't let any situation dictate to us who our God is. You are the almighty, all-powerful God. But you still care for us enough to send your son to die so that we could have fellowship and relationship with you. And we honor you today, Lord. We say thank you. We give you praise as we take this cup. We remember your sacrifice in the name of Jesus. Let's take the cup.
Our hearts as one, we are yours, but your will be done. The promise in your word, we are. we gather. In your presence there is power. When we worship you together, when we gather, oh, in your presence, in your presence there is power. When we worship you together, oh, worship you again.
Out loud, come in power, come in power, Lord. We need to be empowered by you today. We tap into you, Lord, as a power source in the name of Jesus. Thank you. Thank you.
can wash away my sin. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of
thankful that I stand under the blood today, covered, washed, cleansed, forgiven, set free, healed, and made whole. Oh Lord, thank you. This is a safe place to be today. This is a healing place today. This is an accepting place today. This is a place that we've stepped into the presence of God, and that your power is ready and available to change our lives today. Thank you, Father. You are so faithful. We love you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We honor you today. We need you today. We need that precious flow in our lives that makes us whole. We thank you for that. Amen. God bless you in the presence of God today. Thank you, worship team, so much. We want to speak to those of you that might be in the service here at Acts 2 Worship Center for the very first time. And if you are here for the very first time, we want to acknowledge that and say a big God bless you. But I need to know who you are. It helps me know what I need to say next. So if you're here at Acts 2 Worship Center, this is your first time to worship with us. Can I see your hand? First time to worship with us. Hey. You snuck in on me, Pastor. Okay. Anybody else? God bless you. God bless you. All right. Then do something with me. And it's real simple. It's real easy. Take your cell phone in your hand, just like this I'm doing right here. Follow that instruction on the screen. That is so important to me because if you do that, it's going to come to my personal cell phone. And I need to receive that. I want to receive that from you, so that I can respond to you with a big God bless you and a personal reply. If you will take just a minute, connect to our Wi-Fi, real simple. Text the word welcome as if you're going to send a message to that number. That number is me. Plug in that number as a new number, as a new text. Just type the word welcome and click send. You'll get a couple of prompts. Just, I think it's only two. Just to confirm your name and confirm your cell phone number. That helps me so much when you do that. So if you would take just a moment to confirm your name and number, and then I'm going to receive that from you and I can respond to you, and I want to have the opportunity to do that for you. So we'll leave that in front of you for just another few minutes. No, don't want to rush anybody. Just connect to the Wi-Fi, click, text the word welcome to that phone number. And Acts 2 Worship Center, I don't say this very often, but that is the very same phone number for every one of you. If you never receive a text from me, some of you do, but if you never do, you're not in the Acts 2 family group. This group is for those that are guests today, but in order for you to connect to the regular communication that comes from me, you plug in that phone number and type A2WC, click send, and you will be added to my personal text group. We don't talk about that very often, but I just thought I would do that right here as we give our guests a few more minutes to text the word welcome. But you connect to me personally by texting A2WC to the very same phone number that you see right there, and then you'll be a part of my text group. And as I want to send things or remind you or just speak to you as a church, I can do it that way if you join the group. As guests, before you leave, at the end of the service today, as you exit our sanctuary, turn right, keep going right, and on the right, down the hallway on that side, is our Java Lounge. We have some refreshments in there for you today, complimentary, as well as a free personal gift I would like to put into your hand if you'll stop in our Java Lounge before you leave today. Acts 2 Worship Center family, let's let our guests know. We are so glad to have them on this last Sunday in June. I guess it's not yet the middle of summer. No, summer officially just started, didn't it? At the beginning of summer, per se. But anyway, we're going to continue to worship God right here with our tithing. And I want to say a big God bless you for being faithful in your tithe. God bless you as you tithe. Father, we thank you for the tithe. We know the significance of it in our lives. It's a way that we show you that we trust you as our resource, as our source for everything that pertains to life and godliness and prosperity and blessing and healing. And Lord, somewhere over my life, you said there's a window, and that window is open over my life when I walk in the tithe, when I release my tithe to you, and out of that open window, you pour out blessing where there's not room enough to receive so that I can be. Lord, I am blessed for one reason only. I'm blessed to be a blessing. I'm not blessed to feel better, have more, whatever. I'm blessed to be a blessing for somebody else. And Lord, I thank you. I thank you for that principle. It is real in our lives as we walk in the tithe in Jesus' name. Amen. I would like to see you at 5 o'clock. If you've never joined our church membership class happening today with me at 5 o'clock, we're going to meet over here in the Java Lounge, so I would love to have you. Whether you did or didn't sign up, you can still come. We have several of you that did sign up. Thank you for that, but I would love to meet you today for a couple of hours to join us in church membership and all that that means and the blessings I do believe that come with that. So meet me today, 5 o'clock in our Java Lounge. We've got something I'm going to give you a little coming soon heads up about. This is new. I believe something very significant for us. And it is called Tied and True. Tied and True. Marriage enrichment. It's going to be starting the first Sunday in September and will be every first Sunday. Now, it's marriage enrichment, but if you're engaged, We will open this up to engaged couples as well. But we're going to have a wonderful time just making our marriages better. Amen? Marriage can always be better, huh? Boy, so excited about that. So we're going to have a wonderful time, very intimate time, every first Sunday at, I'm sorry, that will start at 5 p.m. Does it have the time there? Yes, 5 to 7. Child care will also be provided for you. Any of you younger couples that still have small children will provide child care. But that's coming up the first Sunday in September. Tide and True Marriage Enrichment Group. And we want all you married folks to be a part of that. It'll be a blessing to you. And that's all the extra things we have to talk about today. Let's stand up and we're going to get ready to bring our offerings. Thank you for your giving that helps keep our missions projects and missions works and prison ministry. They went out today, our prison team, out to the Glades to minister as they do so faithfully. So, Father, thank you again for the opportunity to give, Lord. It's distinctively different than the tithe. We purpose in our heart. Lord, somebody may have gotten the raise, may have been promoted, may have made a sale, may have gotten the contract, may have been blessed in some financial way. And out of that blessing, they want to just give a little extra, want to give an offering so that someone else can be blessed. Lord, thank you, because when we give, your favor rests upon our lives, and we're blessed, and there's more that comes into our hands so that, again, we can be a blessing. So thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give. Fellowship together for just a few moments as well, and don't go home yet, whatever you do. Praise the Lord. I'm going to start reading today from James chapter 1. We'll go as far as we can. I want you to get ready to be challenged. We need our faith challenged from time to time. You know, it's so easy to get into routines and habits and even where our faith is concerned. I believe we need to look into the Word of God and allow the Word of God to challenge us today. And so I pray that that happens for everybody, including me. But we're going to start in James chapter 1, beginning in verse 2. James chapter 1, verse 2. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt. Because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Now get this, this is a strong word. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do. When you ask, you must believe and not doubt. Verse 7 again, that person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Who? The person who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. Now, you may not understand the title. I'm going to show it to you right now based on that as a foundational passage, but you will as we get into this message, because the title of today's message is simply God, our healer. Really? Yes. God, our healer. And you chose James chapter 1? Yes, I did. Because I am a firm believer that the issue that so many people of God have concerning healing is not an issue of your faith, but an issue of doubts. Now, over the years, I have preached about this, but this is a, I believe, foundational message that needs to be visited regularly. I did a series probably 20 years ago. For any of you that are really old timers around here, it was, I don't know, 6, 7, 8, 10 part series called Doubt Busters. And that's what it basically was about. Not that faith is the issue. We've been given faith. God has given us the measure. And Jesus helped us understand, you know, about a little bit about that measure, because he referred to that measure as the size of a grain of mustard seed. That was enough of a measure to speak to mountains in your life and see them removed. And for some, a mountain is a sickness or an infirmity or a disease in your body. And I want you to understand something about healing ministry. Healing ministry did not start with Jesus. God the Father started healing ministry. He's the one who said, I am the God who heals you. So healing ministry didn't even start with Jesus. Remember, don't ever forget this about Jesus. Jesus said more than once, I can only do what I see the Father doing. God the Father was, is, and always will be our healer. Now, Jesus appropriated that healing as a, and I'll say it this way for those of us who believe, as a right for us as believers. Through the cross, the death and the resurrection of Christ, Healing was a part of the atonement that we memorialized again today when we received the bread and the cup. Healing. God the Father started healing ministry. Now, in the process of what we're going to talk about, and I'm going to go into all kinds of things, because you know what my motive is in this? I have an ulterior motive. I want to see some of y'all receive your healing. I want to see you be healed by God the Father, who is your healer. And just maybe this message will help you if there's areas of doubt. And if you have been infirmed, if you have been afflicted for any length of time, you probably have quite a few doubts about healing ministry. One of those could be the will of God doubt. Is it always God's will to heal? Or is God's will different in this area for different people? Could be the divine purpose doubt. Is God using sickness for some divine purpose in my life? Maybe it's the specific timing doubt. Does God have a specific time that He's going to heal me, and therefore He's allowing the sickness, this infirmity, for a season? Or could it be a lack of faith doubt? I'm not being healed because of a lack of faith. A lot of people get stuck right there. A lack of faith. Folks, it is time that we get back to God's Word with all of the winds and waves and fringes and personalities that are trying to teach and reteach what healing ministry is today. We need to get back to the manual on healing ministry. From Genesis to Revelation, we find God as a healer, and we need to get back to instead of studying brother so-and-so's healing ministry, instead of studying prophet so-and-so's healing ministry, instead of running after bishop so-and-so to get your healing, instead of studying what this particular camp or that particular camp says about healing, how about study the manual on healing again and study it morning, noon, and night until every doubt has been crushed and healing will manifest in your life. That's the challenge I want to give you today. And before I leave, I hope I make somebody mad. I said, I hope I actually make you mad enough to finally be healed. I told you last Sunday, God is really much more predictable than we tend to realize. He's more predictable than not. I want to break that out a little bit, which I didn't do that last Sunday, but I felt impressed to do that this Sunday. God is more predictable than He isn't. If I confess my sins to Him, He's very predictable. He will forgive me according to His Word. He has never said to one, you have to do this to be healed, but you have to do this to be healed. You have to do this to be forgiven, but on the other hand, you have to do this over here to be forgiven. You have to believe this way to be healed, but you have to believe that thing to be healed. You can be healed with your doubts, but you can't be healed with your doubts. You can get to heaven this way, but you got to get to heaven that way. That's not our God. God is very predictable, and God is no respecter of persons. God does not show partiality. God does not show favoritism. And folks, as much as I would like to think I never show favoritism, I'm human, I show favoritism, and so do you. There is only one who is impartial in every way, and that is God Himself. There's only one who never shows favoritism to anyone, and that is God, whose love and mercy and forgiveness and predictability is extended to everyone the same way. God welcomes everybody on the same terms. His ways are predictable. His love is also real, very predictable. His grace is very predictable. In the midst of most unpredictable times, where people, culture, politics, finances are more unpredictable than ever, in these times, I am comforted in knowing that my God is predictable. He is the one who says, I am the Lord and I change not. He also says, I watch over my word to perform it. Jesus Christ, the same, predictable, the same yesterday, today, and forever. This book even says heaven and earth are very unpredictable, and they will actually pass away. But the word of the Lord will never pass away. The word of the Lord will stand forever. The word of the Lord is quite predictable. What one person can receive by faith, another can receive by faith, if they meet the conditions, which are the same, because faith is the same. You know, I hate these this politically correct stuff about multi-faith or I'm trying to think of what's that other word that they use for like gatherings, you know, that have every religion under heaven, you know, comes together, and they call them not multi-faith, interfaith. Thank you. I knew it was a word for that. Interfaith. And you know what? There is no such thing. There is only one faith. There are many religions, but this book in the New Testament says we of the body of Christ are of one baptism, one Lord, one faith, one Holy Spirit, one salvation. One cross. There's only one faith, and it's the same, because the originator of faith is God Himself. And so faith is the same. My faith is not different from your faith. Your faith is not different from his faith or her faith or that preacher's faith. If we have faith, and we do, there really is no if, because God said, I have given to everyone the measure of faith. And most of the time, the struggle, the block for people receiving healing is not about faith. You have faith. It's about what we just read in James. If you believe and do not doubt, you'll have whatever you ask for. So that can that include healing? I think when he says whatever you ask for, he says if you don't believe without faith, don't expect to receive anything from the Lord. The will of God is the same in this area. You see, in God's kingdom, the same sin carries the same penalty no matter who it is that commits the sin. If a king lies, the penalty is the same as if a pauper lies. That is the way God's kingdom works. The principle, this principle, is universal because God is no respecter of persons. He does not show partiality in any matter. The spiritual conditions that each believer fulfills, which are revealed in this holy book, will determine their experience with God, no matter who that person is. Yes, but I believe that God is being glorified in my sickness, in my disease. What? Now, there are a whole lot of good church people that believe that. Here's the religious explanation. I've heard things like this over my years in ministry. God may have a divine purpose to bless a sick person through their condition. Therefore, it might not be God's will to heal, or it might not be God's timing to heal until that divine purpose is completed. God's blessing may be that He will teach you a lesson or transform your character through this sickness or this disease, and He cannot accomplish that any other way. Doesn't that sound real theological? That sounds like, well, yeah. Man, our flesh will even agree with that. Here's the reason why I believe that a statement like that is not true. Because the Old Testament, and again, God is our healer, and healing started there. Healing started there. Teaches that sickness is a part of the curse of the law. The curse was always for the disobedient and the wicked. It was never for the righteous. As believers, we are completely forgiven, completely made whole, and perfectly justified before God through Christ and His work at Calvary. Second point, sickness is not listed among the blessings of God anywhere in the Word. Well, He's using this sickness to bless me. Wait a minute. You can't, again, this, you know, the Word of the Lord will stand forever. You can't find that anywhere in here. Distorted reasoning, justified by experiences, possibly the experience of failing to be healed, failing yet to be healed, is used to teach that sickness can be a type of blessing. Anybody getting mad yet? I want some of y'all to get mad. Mad enough to be healed. Let's hear from the prophet Isaiah. Surely He, the Messiah, Isaiah 53, 4 and 5, has borne our griefs, our sicknesses, weaknesses, infirmities, distresses, and carried our sorrows and pains of punishment. Yet we ignorantly considered Him stricken, smitten, and afflicted by God as if with leprosy. But He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our guilt and iniquities. The chastisement needful to obtain peace and well-being for us was upon Him. And with the stripes that wounded Him, we are healed and made whole. Let the Word of God, and let the Word of God be the record, and let the record clearly show that Jesus came to bear upon Him every sickness, disease, and infirmity. And through the cross, we are healed and made whole. Christ's actions when He came on the scene and was born. Remember, Jesus was God the Father in the flesh. God wrapped in the flesh. His attitudes, His teachings. There's nothing about the teachings of Jesus that reveal or even suggest sickness as a blessing. Christ healed all who came to Him without a second hesitation, a prayer, or any consideration that maybe God had some divine purpose for them in that. Christ and His disciples in the New Testament treat sickness just like they do demons. They treat sickness as an enemy. Never as a friend. They never act as if sickness might have a good or godly purpose. You're blind? Let me see. Have you learned your lesson yet? We don't see anything like that. You're blind? Let me see. Can you believe? Do you believe you can be healed? Do you believe you can see again? And they saw. He would heal them. No, you better stay blind a little bit longer. Come to my meeting that I'm having next week over in Galilee. I'll meet you there and see if you've learned your lesson yet. Now, folks, we snicker at this, but there are a whole lot of even Pentecostal people that have come to believe that God is using this sickness in my life to make me holy I just said at the beginning of this message, study the healing manual. Study the Word of God on healing. Not what your own soul will tell you. Not what your own feelings will tell you. And certainly not what your sickness, because your sickness or infirmity has a voice. Hello? The pain in your body is always speaking to you, ain't it? And it's not saying nothing good. It's certainly not telling you to trust God to be healed. It's certainly not telling you you ought to be sick of this pain, sick enough of being sick by now to get healed. It ain't telling you anything like that. Instead of God causing sickness, the New Testament reveals that sometimes demons cause sickness. There are so many Christians who believe there's a divine purpose in sickness and disease that you could possibly be attributing the work of demons as the work of God in your life. God is not behind sickness, disease, infirmity. Let me just echo the Apostle James, who said, my friends, that kind of thing ought not to be. The Bible does not teach anywhere that God wants to use sickness to transform a person's character or produce holiness in them. Rather, He does allow persecution. Now see, this is where we've mingled these two teachings. Persecution and suffering is taught in Scripture, but persecution and suffering is never sickness or disease, as it is taught in the New Testament. God will allow suffering and persecution and trials and testings to produce character in us, but the suffering and the trials and the tests, as taught in the New Testament, are never sickness or disease. Let me give you a little foundational scripture on this. Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. God says, He said, if you listen carefully to the Lord your God and do what is right in His eyes, if you pay attention to His commands and keep all His decrees, I will not bring on you any of the diseases I brought on the Egyptians, for I am the God who heals you. Notice who He brought diseases on. The righteous, the wicked, the Egyptians. Oh, yes. God did not ever curse the righteous Jews with sickness. He would curse the unbelieving, doubting, backslidden. Right, you step out from under the grace of God. That's different. God did not curse the righteous with sickness then, nor does He curse the righteous with sickness today. Sickness falls under curses and healing falls under blessings. Curses are never for the righteous, only for the wicked. Now let me just pause and say this right here. Practicing sin, you invite any and every evil the devil can put on you. Practicing sin can invite sickness and disease into your life. Absolutely. Because in that comes, sin is from the devil, not from God. Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And the practice of sinning against God will give place to the devil in a person's life. If a person is openly and even pridefully sinning against God and His grace in your life, a result can be sickness and disease. Never forget, the wages or the payday for sin is death. According to the Word of God, death, spiritual, physical, emotional, financial, possibly even eternal death, separation from God forever. And Christ came to redeem us from every curse of the law becoming a curse for us as He hung on the cross. So let me challenge you again. If the life and ministry of Jesus contradict what your experiencing or what you're believing, no matter how many years you've believed it or who or what church taught it to you, then what you are believing is false. I've got some of you mad. I'm glad. If the life and ministry of Jesus, and certainly when it comes to healing, contradict your experience, your present experience, based on what you believe, because your experience, my friend, is based on what you believe. Your experience in the area of finance, and just break it all down. The current experience you have in this area is based on what you've been believing about healing. And if it contradicts the Word of God, and certainly if it contradicts the example of Jesus Christ, who is our healer, then what you're believing is false. It needs to be changed. And let me just help you. Let me help you right now. We're going to go through some words real quick, some scriptures. Matthew 4, 23 and 24, Jesus went throughout all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease. Every disease and sickness among the people, healed. No, heal you, not you, not you, not you. You come back next week, not you, not. You haven't suffered long enough. You haven't been sick. Your fever's not high enough. You're not. He healed every sickness and disease among the people. News about him spread over all of Syria, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, even the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them all. And now let me insert again, Jesus Christ, the same, yesterday, today, where I'm at, and forever. Matthew 8, 14, when Jesus came into Peter's house, he saw Peter's mother-in-law lying in bed with a fever. He touched her hand and the fever left her, and she got up and began to wait on him. He was hungry and he needed somebody. No, but anyway, verse 16, when evening came, many who were demon-possessed were brought to him, and he drove out the spirits with a word and healed all the sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet of Isaiah. He took up our infirmities and bore our diseases. Matthew 12, 22. Then they brought him a demon-possessed man who was blind and mute. Blind and could not speak. And Jesus healed him so he could both talk and see. Matthew 14, 14. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed all of the sick. Matthew 14, 35, and when the men of that place recognized Jesus, they sent word to all the surrounding country. People brought all their sick to him and begged him to let the sick just touch the edge of his cloak, and all who touched it were healed. I hope y'all know it wasn't just the woman with the hemorrhage that pressed through and touched the hem of his garment. In another setting, everybody that reached out and touched him was healed. Matthew 15, 30. Great crowds came to him, bringing the lame, the blind, the crippled, the mute, and many others, and laid them at his feet, and he healed them. People were amazed when they saw the mute speaking, and the crippled made well, and the lame walking, and the blind seeing, and they praised the God of Israel. Let the record of the healing ministry of Jesus speak for itself. Luke chapter 6, verse 17, he went down with them and stood on a level place. A large crowd of his disciples was there, and a great number of people from all over Judea and Jerusalem and from the coastal regions around Tyre and Sidon who had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. Those troubled by impure spirits were cured. And the people all tried to touch him because power was coming from him and healing them all. Get mad enough to be healed with somebody today. Since Jesus perfectly demonstrates the will of the Father concerning healing, I believe this clearly shows us that the will, that the Father's will in healing is the same for all. The book of Acts, okay, Jesus has ascended and gone back to heaven now. For all you cessationists, none of y'all in the room today. Acts 5 verse 16 says this, crowds gathered also from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those tormented by impure spirits, and all of them were healed. If healing is not for the body of Christ today, then start in Genesis, and you're going to have to tear out a whole lot of pages out of here. My friend, whatever you do, do not force healing to fit your theology. Allow healing to change your theology. Make your theology be formed around the healing ministry of God the Father, and now continued on and carried on through Jesus Christ. So if healing is not for you, then you have to change God's own words. If healing is not for you, then your God must say to you, I was the God who heals you. Not I am the God who heals you. Jesus never sent anyone away with an explanation that their sickness was working something good in them. Never. There's no indication that Jesus ever believed that sickness was doing anybody any good. He always revealed the Father. The Father wants everyone saved, healed, and delivered from the curse of the law. Matthew 21 verse 18, early in the morning as Jesus was on his way back to the city, he was hungry. Seeing a fig tree by the road, he went up to it but found nothing on it except leaves. Then he said to it, may you never bear fruit again. Immediately the tree withered. When the disciples saw this, they were amazed. How did the fig tree wither so quickly? They asked. Jesus replied, truly I tell you, if you have faith and do not doubt, not only can you do what was done to the fig tree, but also you can say to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea and it will be done. If you believe, you will receive whatever you ask for in prayer. Truly I say, and James reiterated it, we read at the beginning of this message, if you have faith and do not doubt. If you believe and do not doubt, you can receive everything from the Lord. Because James wrote the negative of that, whatever. If you have doubt, you're unstable and don't expect to receive anything from the Lord. But if you have faith and no doubt, you are stable and you should and you will receive from the Lord. You should expect to and you will receive from Him if you believe and not doubt in your heart. You shall have whatever you ask for in prayer. So I came to ask you today, is that the position that you stand upon today concerning healing? Is that your expectation concerning healing? Is that the theology you bind your faith around when it comes to healing? Because I did come to tell somebody today, He is still the God who heals you. You can be healed even today if you will believe and not doubt. I want to ask our pastors, our elders to come. I want each of them to get a little bottle of oil from the prayer altar right here. Because you're in the house of God. Now, this is not the only place you can be healed. Understand that. But James goes on to give us instruction when we gather like this. Let the sick come. If there are sick present, let the elders anoint them with oil, pray the prayer of faith, and God is ready to raise up the sick. But now some of you, before you get here, you need to have a moment with God and confess the doubts. Will of God doubt, specific timing doubt, divine purpose doubt, a bunch of lying nonsense. God is the healer. He always was the healer. He is the healer. And if you've experienced God as healer, wave at me right now. You know God as healer. You know Him as healer. And there are those of you in this service, some that aren't here because of sickness, but there are some that are here. You need a healing in your body, in your life somewhere. Now, again, God's the healer. When we pray for you, we anoint with oil, we're being obedient to the instruction of God's word. He said, lay hands on the sick, anoint them with oil, pray a prayer of faith. God will forgive if there's any sin, and He will raise up the sick. God will do it. So come today. Leave the doubts in the seat. Come here in faith. Faith that you already have. Believing for God to heal you today, that you can be healed today. Would you come? Just step in front of one of our elders. They're going to anoint you with oil, or one of our pastors. Elsa, you need to be up here with George. Okay. Come up here and just step in front of them. They're going to anoint you with oil. Again, nobody standing here heals anybody. God heals. And we're going to do what God told us to do. Pray the prayer of faith and believe God with you. Renounce every doubt. Repent of the doubts. Confess doubts, and He will forgive you and wash every doubt away, because you've got to come without doubting in order to receive from the Lord. Come this morning without doubting. Prayer team, pray the prayer of faith. Be sensitive to those that are waiting so we don't spend too much time with each person. Pray a prayer of faith. Make a point of contact, and we're believing God for healing today. God is the healer. I didn't give you my opinion. Believe me, a lot of what I gave to you today made me uncomfortable. It made me uncomfortable, but I wanted you to get God's word about healing. I wanted you to get the word of God concerning healing, so that not only will your faith be stirred, but your faith will rise up in you and crush every doubt. Let every doubt be crushed in Jesus' name. Let every doubt be crushed in Jesus' name. Let every doubt be crushed in Jesus' name. So, Father, we pray the prayer of faith right now. And we believe you, Lord, that you are our healer. Lord, I believe you're my healer. I renounce doubts. Lord, I confess my doubts to you. Forgive me. Wash the doubts away. I believe you fresh today. You're my healer right now. Healing ministry is for today. Healing ministry is a part of the cross. And Lord, I receive the healing today that you have for me. I receive that healing today. I thank you for healing in Jesus' name, Father. You are the healer. You are the healer. We thank you for healing today. We thank you for healing today. We receive your healing by faith today. We receive your healing by faith. I receive my healing by faith. I know you are a healer, Father. I know you are no respecter of persons. Lord, your word and your promise about healing is very predictable. And we tap in right now. We tap in right now. We tap in right now. We thank you right now, Lord, for the healing that is mine. It is mine, Lord. Lord, you are my healer. You're speaking that word to me. You are my healer. You are my healer today. Thank you, Father, for healing me. Thank you, Lord, for healing me. Thank you for revealing your healing power in my life. Thank you, Father, right now for the healing that is mine. Thank you for the healing that is mine. Thank you for the healing that is mine. Thank you for the healing that is mine. I receive today. I receive today. I know healing is now. I know you are the God that heals. I know you are my God, my healer. And Lord, I receive healing now. Lord, you know exactly what it is. Well, I don't need to know, because you know, Father. I'm just praying the prayer of faith right now and anointing with oil and laying hands upon them in the name of Jesus, making a point of contact. Lord, because you said do it, and that if we would do it, you would release healing in people's lives. Release that healing now in Jesus' name. 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 Thank you for healing. Thank you for healing. Thank you for healing. Thank you for healing, Father. 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 Thank you for healing. You stand in the gap where you are. Pray for your brothers and sisters. Send your faith. Send your faith their way. Send your agreement their way. There's power in agreement. Agree in prayer with these that are here today as you sit there. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We anoint with oil and pray the prayer of faith. And we thank you for revealing your healing power. You are our healer, Lord. You are our healer, Lord. You're my healer, Lord. You're my healer, Lord. I receive it from you today, Father. I receive it from you today, Father. I receive healing today. Lord, my faith is stirred. My faith has been renewed. My faith has been challenged, Lord. I will not listen to the lies of the enemy. You are still healing. You're a healing God. You're still a healer. Lord Jesus, you touched and healed everybody, and we believe you again. We join our faith together. We stand in for our brothers and sisters that are believing God for healing, and we thank you, Father, for your healing touch. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your healing, Lord. Thank you, Father. I will not doubt, Lord. You are my healer. You are my healer. You are my healer. Of course, with men, it's impossible, but all things are possible with you, God. Nothing is impossible to him, to her, who believes and does not doubt, and does not doubt. Thank you, Father. 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 Thank you, Lord. I receive my healing from you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Touch time. Thank you, Father. You're his healer. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. We pray the prayer of faith. Thank you for his healing. You're his healer. You're his healer. You're his healer, Father. Thank you, 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 Father. Understand, the devil always comes to steal. You walk out of here believing and knowing in your heart and in your mind, I am healed in the name of Jesus. God is still a healer. I know him as healer today. In the morning, he's still my healer. And on Tuesday, he's still my healer. And Wednesday and Thursday, he's still my healer. And when I feel that pain, he's still my healer. When I cough, he's still my healer. When I take that prescription, he's still my healer. Do not doubt, and your healing will manifest in your body. And that's not my promise. Please don't leave here thinking I'm challenging. That's my challenge. That's the promise and the word of God Almighty to you that need healing from him. He is still your healer. He is still your healer. He's still your healer. Let's be sensitive to this around the altar. But as you're ready to be dismissed, you can dismiss yourselves in his presence and in his healing, and you can go home with that in Jesus' name. God bless you today.